Not in the slightest. In fact, I'm still feeling a little confused about exactly what show it is that we are actually going to do today.
You know that Terry Avery was asking something about this Charlottetown anniversary.
What's really scary is how well everybody lied. It makes me think that we are all congenital liars.
Well, pathological. Right?
Pathological.
Leslie has always confessed to being a pathological liar, and I think this is proof positive. Now, we know.
So how many minutes to game time?
Okay, right now we have 10 minutes to go. It's now 10 to, well, we'll have 14 minutes and 30 seconds, actually. And the only thing we're really hoping is that Whit doesn't kill us at the end of all this. That's our earnest desire, and that he knows that we did it in the nicest possible way.
Sure. Okay, see ya.
See you, Pat.
What do I have to do?
Okay, so you dial the number. Actually, you push power first.
Power, yeah. Then one, then dial.
And the other number?
1-9-0-2-4-3-7-2-0-1-0.
And then send. Then push the red button, send.
And then that one.
Red lights
yes.
on though.
What are you talking about?
We're just talking about photography.
Do you want me to give you a roll?
Pardon?
Whatever film I shoot, do you want that today or will I come by tomorrow or something?
Well, I'm actually going away for a week and a bit, so you know, it's up to you. Whatever you want to do.
I could probably wait till you come back.
Yeah, why don't we do that?
Something as simple as, like, what was the name of the station you worked at in Aramith?
Although, don't ask me what the call letters were, because
I know, because my brother worked there, yeah.
Okay.
So, why can we get you to ask that question? We'll just say we're minutes away from a little surprise get-together for Whit Carter. He was here for, what, 20?
Oh, since
half. I can't remember that, can you?
Well, he's been broadcasting for 40 years.
40 years.
So, therefore, he's been here. He was in Yerma for a year, and he was in Halifax for a year, and then the rest of his time has been spent here, so it's well over 30
years.
We're
going to get Whit's wife to ask the trivia question before we go in, and then we'll capture him and get a bit of that. So we'll get to...
Can we bring you over here?
This will be good, Pat. This will be good.
What do you think about this, Joyce? What do you think about it?
I think it's wonderful. He's going to do the house cleaning. He's going to do the cooking. He's going to do all those wonderful things that I've been doing for 36 years.
He's going to get a surprise today, won't he?
Oh, yes, he is. He sure is.
We're saving this tape for him.
Are you? Wonderful.
So we'll start in the end.
Don't you?
Level? 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10. We'll start on the 2, maybe. Yep. Hi,
Hi, we're back, and we're here with family and friends of Whit Carter. Now, Whit is retiring after 40 years of broadcasting. We all know Whit from radio work, and this is Joyce, Whit's wife. Now, Joyce, since we have a trivia question, why don't you ask something about Whit's past, his career?
All right. Where did he start his career? What grade was he? Was he working when he first started 40 years ago?
And it was in Yarmouth, so we'll ask.
Yes, it was Yarmouth.
We'll ask the call letters of the radio station in Yarmouth. What's it going to be like to wait at home now?
Oh, it's going to be wonderful. He's going to do the washing, the cooking, the cleaning, and I'm going to have a wonderful time.
Great, Joyce. Okay, now if you know the answer to that, please give us a call. We're going to go in and surprise him in a minute.
Yes, we sure are.
Okay.
Better say something. Hi.
Want to say hi to grandfather?
Oh, come
don't
on.
Don't be shy. Listen, stand out here and talk to Nan. This is just for our own use, Kayla.
Yeah, this part won't be on TV.
Yeah, this won't be on.
Okay. Well, I'll let her maybe later.
She wrote a poem for grandfather, and she's going to give him flowers. Here's Joan. Yeah.
Nice.
Yeah.
Okay. Well, we'll see you in there.
She's being camera shy. She really is.
See you later. Like them.
John Police Chief Dave
Sherwood. There's a ramp.
They hired the best.
Well, I tell you.
Oh, I like that Cyclops look.
The strike by Ontario civil servants is all but over, according to the union's president, Leah Castleman.
And then
Castleman expects a deal signed by the government. Employees have been on strike for over.
No. Just shut me around. I push it.
She says it was hard to swim, but with her husband's help, she rescued her dog.
You look relaxed?
I am relaxed. Leslie's got this all planned down to the very last detail.
Better than doing a telephone.
That's right.
Not as
she's
crowded.
The queen of remotes.
Not as crowded.
Not as crowded. That's right. So, well, people will come later.
Okay.
I'm sure.
A healthy 8-pound girl. Jane McElhone.
And we said
at RCMP say they've arrested 170 people in a Canada-wide crackdown on alcohol and tobacco smugglers. We claim millions of dollars in contraband came through the Atlas Avenue Reserve in Eastern Ontario.
Coming up.
This is CBC Radio News.
Good afternoon. Welcome to Main Street. I'm Whit Carter.
I'm Nils Ling.
And I'm Cheryl McKay.
Definitely no warning. Man.
You never
let me take off my glasses to like see who was here.
We've got to tell you that as we were doing the intro, the room has filled up with all kinds of people who've come to wish Whit well today as we go on. You had no idea?
Absolutely none.
To the point where a man who's been
who's
in broadcasting
here?
For years and years and years doesn't hold the microphone up to his mouth.
And now we have the grandchildren who are here who are in on the secret as well. They've got some too.
We have a terrific show lined up.
Hey.
We're going to start it with some music from Barry Sorensen and his band. Let's go, Barry.
Yeah, a little bit.
Yeah.
I just can't believe this.
They love you.
Blame her. Blame all of them.
They got you good.
Right now on the island, it's minus 2 degrees and sunny in Charlottetown. Wind
I don't know.
Northwest at 28 to 55 kilometers.
Absolutely
an hour.
Nothing.
The barometric pressure is 101.7 at
I don't know how, you know, I have no idea how people at the CBC could keep secrets like this.
You didn't hear Wayne on the air this morning, eh?
No.
The voice was designed to make sure you weren't listening. They promoted this one. Everybody's more than welcome.
Between 8:30 and 9 this morning, they were talking about it.
That's unreal.
Can we do it? You know what they have this store for you. It's going to be great.
Well, what can I do for the rest of the
Nothing.
Afternoon?
Nothing. Enjoy. Sit down and pay attention.
And listen closely. Good stuff to come.
That's a good one.
Good stuff to come. Listen closely.
There are dozens of them, and they continue to pour in, and we hope folks out there listening will drop by to say hi as well.
That's right. I'm sitting here with Jill Hanson. Jill, you worked a long time with on the compass, and I think actually your desk
was right next
to each other. Our desks were so close together that when anything happened, we were all that we were in a tiny little cubby, not just Whit and I, but our research to be holding. And then Mark Burrell, I think, Whit was there too. We were in a very small office that I think is now maybe a smoking room. But yes, it wasn't that long. It was only about maybe a year and a half. And it was a long time ago, 1975, 1976, 20 years.
That's hard to believe. Yeah.
Do you have a favorite sort of a story that you'd like to tell about Whit? I think when Whit worked with me on Compass, he was doing what he really didn't like to do, which was television. He really wasn't a very happy guy working on Compass, right, Whit?
His heart was in radio.
His heart was in radio, but he did it because he had to do it. I like to think that I lightened up his life a little bit because I was a young 24-year-old idiot who was a lot of our
boundless energy.
With boundless energy, and a lot of it was live. Most of our television was live, so we had to be, it was very stressful. And I did some interviews that created some problems with some people, and I used to get mail that wasn't always mail that I wanted to get. And one day this little box arrived in the mail, and it was wrapped, it was a parcel, and I jiggled it, and it rattled, and I thought it was a brooch, or I said, Whit was sitting right there, because we were so close together. And I said, what is this? I'm going to open it up, and I opened it up, and as soon as I looked inside, it was a dead mouse.
Oh.
But it wasn't just a dead mouse, it was a dead bleeding mouse.
Oh.
It was very gross. And I absolutely flipped, flung it in the air, and it landed on Whit. But Whit was completely unflappable. And as usual, he just picked it up, looked at it, spent the next hour and a half calming me down, you know, and said everything was going to be okay. That's the kind of guy Whit was when I knew him, and I did. He was probably the age I am now when I knew him in his mid-40s. And he was a very, he was like a father figure for me and for any of the other young people who were around there. He was absolutely a wonderful person to work with, even though he hated television.
And we've all found him that way as well.
Yeah.
Jill, any hints on retirement? Now, you're in retirement that you haven't looked forward to, but any hints for Whit?
Well, I was talking to our former researcher, Judy Halton, last night about Whit, and she said, what's Whit going to do when he retires? And I said, I don't know. I don't think he's thought about it. She said, buy him a self-help book for retirement, because he's really going to need it. My feeling is he'll probably be back hanging around the CBC as much as he can. He has some grandchildren, though. Maybe he'll keep busy that way.
That's right, and I think, actually, Joyce has a list for him. Right?
I bet, at home. I'm sure she does.
Thanks so much, Jill. Thanks for coming.
You're very welcome.
We'll talk to you later on. Yeah.
And another colleague, longtime colleague of Whit's is Donelda McLeod. Donelda co-hosted with Whit for 4.5 years. And Donelda, tell us about your audition for the job.
That was fun. There were 28 of us. And we did all the usual things. Come up with a story idea, research it, script it, tape it, edit it, and so on and so forth. And everyone had to interview Whit. That was the last thing. And we were all quite nervous about it. And I'm sure everyone was doing the same interview. Why did you get into radio? When did you know that's what you wanted to do? How did you begin? So I thought, well, I should do something different. And someone had told me that he recently had lost 20 pounds. I'm always interested in he lost 20 pounds. And how? So I talked to him, and then that was the focus I took. And I found out he was quite disciplined. He had done this, not easily. And as the interview went along, I thought, well, he probably has done this in other areas too. So I said, have you given up anything else? And well, I didn't say I gave up something. And I gave up. And then I heard myself say, nice to you. Somebody else was saying it. Whit broke up, I broke up, and I thought, boy, did I ever blow this job. I thought I wasn't going to get it at all, but I did. And that sweet man, who was an enormous man, very nervous, hadn't done on-air work like that before, not where it was co-hosting afternoon. And so he was the rock and Gibraltar next to me. He gave me very good advice. He said, concentrate, because I had foot and mouth disease the first few weeks I was at him. So he was solid, stellar, great guy.
And you have brought with you just a little token of your appreciation. Don't let him run away.
No, you mustn't run away, but this is for you.
Oh, thank you.
Oh, my love. And I know you're going to have a great time. Imagine you. And you're going to be living on the South Shore of PEI this summer, and that is God's perfect PEI.
Oh, isn't it?
Last.
Yeah.
I could walk from Victoria and meet you halfway. Oh, Joyce will come too.
Probably. Okay.
But anyway.
We'll see you on the beach.
Yeah, we'll see you on the beach. Well, before then, too. Yeah. But anyway, the best is yet to come. Absolutely.
Thank you.
You're welcome. Thanks for all the help you did for me.
Thank you,
Danilo. Oh, not at all. Lovely to be here. Great to
meet you. All right.
We are live at the Robinson's Lounge in the Charlottetown Hotel this afternoon. It is our Main Street party for his retirement that's happening after tomorrow. So please drop by if you could just come on down and say hello. We're here for the next 2 hours this afternoon. Now, it was a man, everybody knows, who was the person who gave Whit his first job at CFCY. Bob Large hired Whit back in 1957. And he has this kind of a story to tell about a very unusual first day at work.
Well, my most unforgettable memory of Whit is actually the very first day he arrived at CFCY. Our elderly caretaker lived up on the third floor of a building at 85 Kent Street. He had been ill for quite a while, and unfortunately he passed away that very afternoon. Anyway, the funeral director decided it would be best if we delayed removing him until after the offices were closed. And so that sounded like a good idea to me, so I waited around because I knew Whit was going to arrive late that afternoon, too. And to make a long story short, just as they were removing the body out the front door of the building, lo and behold, Whit walks up the front walk. And the look on his face, I will never forget. In any event, that little episode passed very quickly, and Whit and I had a few lighthearted remarks about, is that what happens to announce you that don't make the grade and such foolishness? But anyway, we made our arrangements, and Whit came on staff, and he turned out to be one of the best employees that we'd ever had. And my memory of Whit always is that he was reliable and dependable. And if I had to do it all over again, I'd hire him tomorrow.
Although I don't know that he'd want to repeat that first day. That was Bob Large, who was the general manager at CFCY for many years, and the guy who gave Whit his first job in Charlottetown.
Another veteran of CFCY was Helen Herring. And Helen was a pioneer in island broadcasting. She spent 35 years at CFCY. Anyone here remember her show Today at Home? A few nodding heads, yes. She and Whit worked together for 10 years.
A very young man when I met him at CFCY, where we were both on radio, I think, at that time at least. And I don't have any great memories of Whit, except that I always knew he was a perfectionist and was really professional in his career. One little story that might illustrate that point would be one day he had a newscast to do, and I understand that when it's written, you read what's on it. And he knew he had mistaken it, and I think a little secretary was told that she had to be more careful in future. But he very seldom ever fluffed a line. I always admired Whit's ability, and he certainly was a good newscaster all through his whole career. I would wish him a very happy retirement. He deserves it, and to wish him the best.
That's Helen Herring. She was a pioneer in island broadcasting, 35 years at CFCY.
You're listening to Main Street on CBC Radio, 20 minutes after 4 o'clock. Time for some more music from the Barry Sorensen Quartet. Mm-hmm.
Robbins is going to the Charlottetown Hotel where we are. If you had been listening to Whit over the last couple of days, you would have thought we were down here for a special tea dance. In fact, we are down here.
I thought
he's still looking for a dance. still waiting for a dance, are you?
Not really, Mills. Why didn't you guys tell me that we're doing this?
Then it wouldn't have been a surprise. But at any rate, we've surprised Whit with a bunch of friends and colleagues, both in person and on tape. And Cheryl, I think you've got one of those.
I worked so hard on all those scripts today that I was.
I was going to talk with Barry.
I was going to tell you about all the furniture I got from the hotel years ago.
Well, we still have time for stories from you, Whit.
Oh dear, no, as long as Barry just keeps playing that great music, that's the thing. Yeah, he's terrific.
You know, we have a voice here from our recent years with. This is someone who worked with you on Island Morning and went on to network radio. Here's Suzanne Blake.
The first thing to say, I remember having a lot of fun. I think you can sense of humor and all of his bad as my own. I recall, I believe it was Whit and I who set Wayne Collins' a script on fire one morning in the studio. All of us laughed at anything better to do. Quite enjoyed that. And I was reminded by a technician of the time Whit was trying to do a new update in the studio, and I proceeded to get on all those fancy little buttons he has, and I sang Happy Time Crazy into his ear for the entire time. But Whit, he went hopeless on the rough. But we had a good couple, and Whit and I always had a lot of fun. That's exactly what I remember. I used to tease Whit about being my father, but then I used to tell you about my grandfather. I used to give him a hard time. Seriously, and he was best explained for how things work. Oh, just sort of what the TI was all about, and the savings, but also journalistically. I got a lot of ideas about this game. He was very good at getting me going early in the morning and telling me what things I should be watching. And that, I think, even went outside of work. I remember one time my car broke down to the Kmart parking lot. It's still there at University Avenue. And I said, now what do I do? I was all alone. My family was in Newfoundland. I had nobody. I wasn't married yet. That I'm going to call Whit. So I called him, and he, of course, hopped in his car and came down to what all the trouble was. We got there straight away and off I drove. So Whit was always the person I knew that I could count on. If anything went wrong, be it my personal life or be it my journalistic life, I could count on him for anything and everything. And I held on. I remember when we both had our steps come together by the window over on the University Avenue in the morning. We would chat and chat and chat and chat. It could be fans. It could be things unmentionable, it could be work, so that could be anything. And I was always enjoying it with the company. He knows that I think I told him, I hope I told him how much he meant to me when I was there and when I was never come across anybody who quite fill that voice for me at any other CBC location I work. So there you go, another feather in your cap, because I know about the world feather. Give him a great big kick for me.
Network sports.
Just a great gal.
Do you remember the day that you rescued her in the parking lot?
Yes, I do. Yeah, I was home and she called me.
We have more Whit rescue stories coming up later on in the show today, too.
Have you really?
Yeah.
Boy, this is going to be interesting.
What I want to hear is, I want to hear about Whit. Adam Morning, of course, you know, gets all the hot stories. Did you surf on fire, Wayne?
Absolutely. That was one of our humorous moments we've had on the show. But just listening to Suzanne there reminds me of the time Suzanne, Whit, and myself were working together doing Island Morning. And what a great relationship all three of us had. It was a wonderful time doing the program. And Whit was the great arbiter between Suzanne and I. He was like the kindly father who settled the disputes and kept peace around the place. A steady anchoring influence amongst the other children.
I know you're taking special joy in this day because of the surprise that we were able to spring on.
Oh, I wish everyone could have seen Whit's face when we strolled through the door here at the lounge, and he was just frozen in shock and trauma. Are you recovered yet, Whit?
Not really, but it was almost worse than being in the middle of two Newfoundlanders.
That's right. You were like a Newfoundland sandwich there.
Yes,
for a few years.
Yes, indeed. The worst part of it all is that you're speechless, and you want to tell everybody, you know, how impressed you are with what you guys are doing, and I just don't have the words.
Words just don't come.
Nobody wrote me a script for this thing.
After 40 years, you're entitled for the words not to come, at least once after 40 years.
Thanks, buddy.
Congratulations, Whit.
Okay, and we'll have more from the Charlottetown Hotel right after the 4:30 news.
He's laughing, but this is true, because I just started in this business about 3 years ago, and I came in, and here's Whit, who, you know, the seasoned veteran, the old crusty newsman. He wasn't crusty at all. He's the greatest guy in the world, and he still has his energy and his enthusiasm for the job, which is something that I think people my age can only hope for and hope to strive for. So, Whit, you're setting an example, and man, I don't know if we can follow it, but I'm sure going to try. You're the greatest. I love this guy.
Everybody knows him.
Yes. Everybody here.
What I remember about this most of all is that
Some of us were delighted to take what's called a storm deck. We were storm safe at home, and we had to see that. This is a thing, this is not good for Whit Carter. Whit Carter, he put on his boots, he put on his coat, and he carried Gary Leach here. He never did get his point. That's why this boat is here. He doesn't strike me as the kind of guy who would mush to the North Pole, but there, Whit Carter's an unusual man. And I must have been glad to have the opportunity.
Jeff Turnbull, one of the first producers of Island Morning, and mushing? What's a mushing?
Time for some more music now. Here's the Barry Sorensen Quartet.
They got us mixed up, but they knew we were together most of the time.
They didn't know who was who.
No. It's like if you saw Roland and Martin standing there, you wouldn't know who's who, but you know who they were and what they did.
As a couple, yeah.
That's right, yeah.
We were in every little corner store and fire department in the BBI, I think, when we were going around promoting shows. And that's what would happen. We'd come in, and one of us would say, well, we're Ed Waters and Whit Carter. And I guess probably we never really told them which one was which. That's where the confusion was, I think.
And on top of that, we were on the broadcast facility at the same time, all the time. Even when we were doing television. If I did the news at 7 o'clock, he was standing right next to me doing a quiz show. And there was no separation whatsoever. We complained a lot of it, but I think we were happy.
Oh, I think so. Yeah, it was probably some of the best years of our life.
Ed, thank you so much for stopping by today.
It's my pleasure, and I just have one word of advice on his retirement that I mentioned to his wife Joyce a couple of moments ago. That every morning you get up, make sure you put on your shoes and use it. Congratulations
right
to all of
us.
Thanks so much. That's Ed Waters, longtime announcer and broadcaster on the 790.
Okay. Good, buddy.
Long time in radio. It's also got lots of friends in television, and we work in television as well. But Beth Murphy is the director of Compass on CBC TV, and she remembers very well how she first came to meet Whit.
So, probably 13, 14, 15 years old.
Really?
Yes, indeed.
You were surprised. And you might want to go back to the old days, but I can remember Whit Carter. I was at the farm in North Winslow, and in those days, it was John Carter and Stuart Dixon.
Yes,
7:30 news. Farm chores done. Get out of the barn. There's no lights and no three.
Check the board and train time.
Check the board and train time. And then along came the CFCY 7:30 news, brought to you by the Enterprise Foundry Company Limited of Sackville, New Brunswick.
You got it. You could do a commercial for
if
that.
You didn't have an Enterprise stove, you weren't in it. I can remember its honesty and integrity in those early days. And then when I went to the Department of Agriculture, lo and behold, there's Whit. He's with CFCY still, and we were doing farm report in the early going. And then when I went to CBC, Whit was a couple or 3 years ahead of me there. So it's been a long association. And I understand when he retires, which he's going to be doing officially tomorrow, that he's joining the Honeydew Company. You know, a lot of people don't remember that Joyce is the Islander, not Whit, right?
That's right.
So when you say to some older people in the community, they remind me of that, that he married an Islander, and she's a good girl. She's from the cove, right?
You got it.
And now he's here.
Yeah. We wish you all the best, and that Honeydew Company is Honeydew this, Honeydew that.
I know
a big
that.
Long list, right?
Thanks, bud. Listen, I have a card here that I just got to acknowledge, and it's from Jock Southern. Now, does everybody know who Jock Sutherland is? If they don't, well, he was our very first fan and critic on Information Morning when we started in 1977. And Jock and I go back even further than that, back to when I first went to CFCY in 57. He was the weatherman on television. Yes, indeed. He has Boomer by a few years.
He didn't wear shorts, did he?
Jock is in his 90s right now, and he didn't wear shorts. No.
Whit, all the best. It's been a long association, a pleasant one, and good luck, my friend.
Thanks, Roger.
And that's Roger Younger, of course, from Congress.
And time to hear now on tape from another of Whit's colleagues from 1969 to 1973. Colin Cooper worked with Whit at CFCY and then over at CBC from 73 to 80. And through the years, they became great friends.
PEI has changed a lot during Whit's long career. He's still the same person I met maybe 30 years ago. His popularity never went to his head. Whit has always been honest, fair, and kind of a shy guy, but boy, he'd be stubborn. After Bob Betty Large sold CSCY to a group from the mainland. Whit only cared about the audience. When the conversation was losing perspective, he would dig his heels. It never made the bosses happy, but it sure left a lasting impression on us rookies just getting started in private radio. I owe Whit much for what he taught me about broadcasting and for what he and his wife Joyce have meant to me and my family for nearly 3 decades. I hope Whit's voice continues to be heard on the island. While Whit deserves a bit of a rest, islanders deserve to continue hearing from him. Whit and Joyce Carter are my children's godparents. And when the children were infants, up until, well, now they're all grown up. When they were really small, they used to spend lots of time with their surrogate grandparents. Joyce had this incredible way of getting Whit really irritated. Oh, Jesus, Joyce. When my kids start talking, anytime they hear any kind of commotion in the house, one of them would trip up. Jesus, Joyce. When they go over to visit now, we'll always say, at some point during the visit, we'll say all expressions, Jesus, Joyce. With Joyce have been a part of our family for nearly 30 years. And we're so lucky to have had them. You know, we're not the only ones. I bet that if you start counting up all the friends with his name in broadcasting, who they've kind of adopted over the years, it would be enormous.
That's Colin Cooper, Whit's long-time friend.
She's in Vernon River.
More memories about Whit and more music from the very
That's my woman.
So stay with us. We'll be back after Canada at 5.
Anyway, you take care.
This afternoon, I said, this is almost my last day, so why in the hell don't I call everybody that I know in the CBC who are in far-flung places, you know, get my last phone call out of the mother club. And I said, I said, the hell with the mother father. So the only one I called was Colin Cooper in Montreal, the guy that was on here a while ago. And I got nothing but a message saying he wasn't there or something. So I just left a message saying, you know, listen, Cooper, it's my last day. I just thought I'd better let you know. And that was the only call that I made. Then he turns up on this friggin' tape. I don't know when it was taped.
With the captain and the so-called quote unquote.
Didn't you think this was kind of a stupid idea for a show today?
Yeah, but I told the producer that and she had some silly answer, so I, you know.
Now, do you remember about 6 weeks ago when I came into the military show unit and said, Whit, I need a band that sort of has a big band sound but isn't 16 pieces. Who would that be? And you said, oh, Barry Sorensen. And I looked at Leslie and we went, right, okay, now we know who the band is.
So it goes back that far, does it?
Right over your head.
You even chose your own band, didn't you?
So are these guys are your faves, eh?
It's only a big band in town.
That isn't 16 pieces. There was a budget, you know.
Yeah. They're saving them until Saturday night, I'm told. But anyway, no, I said to Leslie, I said, you know, this is kind of a commercial thing, isn't it? With Ross Hotel. I said, what the hell? How are you getting away with that? She had some kind of stupid answer. So.
Well, Whit does everything that Leslie asked him to. We all know that. In fact, when Leslie leaves the corporation, Whit is going to keep her as a pet. For a project, a pet.
Yeah, she's going to live in my basement.
She'll live in her basement. She'll be Whit's project.
My grandson, Jason the Girl.
The kids kept
hey, I'd like to say that.
Did you see the great?
Works on very devious people. Looks like they caught him again. I think the last time on his 60th birthday. But he was surprised. I just want to add my congratulations to all of the rest that he's getting today. And that's my story. I can relate. Couldn't really think of one that I could use on the air. Number probably couldn't. Just want to tell the Whit to use the month of April to shine up his golf clubs. He's going to need them this summer. I'll be over for a lot of games.
Oh, that's my brother.
Is who?
It's my brother.
I took him on. You
all kids. Enjoy your retirement. You worked hard. You deserve it. Very few years. I hope to join you in it.
That's Jerry Carter, yeah. Whit's brother with good wishes. Yes, I guess we are a little devious, aren't we?
Yes, I know.
And I'm Joel. And I'm Joel. Okay, the other devious one. Or another of the devious ones.
And we're down at the Charlottetown Hotel in the Province's Lounge, broadcasting live from there in a special kind of tribute to Whit Carter.
Yes, earlier today we completely surprised Whit at when we opened the show. We thought we were here to do a completely other show. In fact, he was promoting that other show all day. Worked very hard getting ready for it. But here we are now, we sort of roll over his eyes. And for the next hour, we're continuing to celebrate Whit Carter. And we invite you to join us. As Bill's mentioned, we're at the Charlottetown Hotel in the Province's Lounge. We're here for the next hour and after that as well. There's food and drinks available down here.
We were saying that not everybody in here is devious, and you're thinking of coming down and joining us, but it doesn't escape my attention that not one of these people who are all friends of Whit's mentioned it to him. So I guess we are all devious, and yes, we've had great music all day, and we're ready to hear more of it now from the wonderful Barry Sorensen Quartet.
traffic. I know a lot of people have been talking about how much of a pro it is and what a nice guy he was to work with. I just got to tell you that last week when I was working with him, I found him to be rather demanding. For example, he wanted verbs in his news copy. Next day he'd like a subject. The next day it was a predicate, an object, a subject. I just couldn't keep him happy. I'm quite glad that I'm not working with him anymore.
Thanks, Max.
Sandy, boy. Remember Sandy? He used to be a mouth.
Two good friends.
One went to the driving theater. Big day? Anyway. What?
Sure is. It's
been a long time coming.
I always thought either Frank or Whit would end up doing the national on the CBC. They were that good. Because back at CFCY radio and television. And Whit would do the news on television. And I thought he was very, very good. I used to do the car commercial. He did the news. I would do a live car commercial. But we had a lot of fun back in those days at CFCY. What a guy. He should be poster boy for Mr. Canada.
Well, I don't know about a poster boy for Mr. Canada, but as Sandy Hoyt mentioned, Whit did get the girl, and surely you got the girl there.
That's right. Joyce Carter's with me now. Oh, we just a little bit of upset. We'll just stand up here. That's the way we're doing that pie and just spill. Now, what do you think? Poster boy for Mr. Canada?
Sure.
Well, I don't know about that. If he wanted to, I suppose he could. Now, I understand that you've been working on a bit of a list for Whit.
Yeah, it's, I've taken this from friends of ours, Ronnie and Gene Johnson. Ronnie retired about a year or so ago, and Gene has given him a honey-do list. So I'm adapting that, thanks to Gene. I will have his honey-do list, you know, honey-do this, honey-do that. So he's going to do the cleaning and the cooking, and I see no reason why I shouldn't retire.
Well, this is going to be quite a change then, to have Whit around in the daytime.
Yes, it is. I'm still going to work, but he'll be around. I'm going to hopefully he'll go to Hawaii with me and go walking and busy that way. CBI.
Yeah.
He's not promoting my bucket.
I'm on the honey-do list.
Now, there are a couple of other people here, and one of them decided to be with me on the radio. But introduce me to who else is here first.
Well, this is, first of all, this is our daughter, Carolyn Dorrington.
Hi, Carolyn.
Hello.
We're here from Nova Scotia, and this is our grandson, Brian. And both Kayla and Brian have written a little story for Grandfather. And I think Brian's going to read this, but Kayla's being shy, and Carolyn's going to do it for her.
That's right. Mom is stepping in to read for Kayla. Brian, let's hear what you've got written there for your grandfather. What did you write down on the paper?
When Grandmother retires, he'll be able to play games, read stories, movie on the beach.
And would you like to be involved in all of that, Brian?
Yes.
Yeah. It sounds like you've got another list of things for him to do.
Yep, grandchildren list.
That's right, a grandchildren list. And Carolyn, why don't you read what Kayla's written here?
Kind of unusual, she's shy, but anyway, it's usually me. She's written, when Grandfather retires, he can spend more time with us. Grandfather can play games, go fishing, although Brian and Grandfather went fishing there last year, and the only fish they caught was the one on Grandfather's hat. They like to go walking. Of course, they go walking on the rocks, where Grandfather carved their names on the rocks. Go canoeing and go swimming. And she puts down here that he'll not have to get up at 6 o'clock.
An important consideration.
Yes, and she's also written a song here. Of course, she's into music, and I'm not quite sure how the tune goes, but I'll just read it. It says, Grandfather, Grandfather, let's go walking down the pointy ways. Grandfather, Grandfather, let's go walking, I love you today. Kayla Joyce Thornton.
And how old is Kayla?
Kayla's 8.
That's wonderful. Boy, they've got some lists made up for you too, Whit. Thanks a lot, Carolyn.
You're welcome.
And thanks to Brian, who's actually gone back to coloring, and to Kayla, who is still coloring as well. And Joyce, all the best to you.
Thank you. And I must say, before you let me go, we have been talking to our son, Robbie,
And of course, Robbie said, "Mom, I can't even leave a message on an answering service, so therefore I wouldn't do anything on tape, but he does send with his best wishes and his love." It's from Rob and Sue and Amy and Sarah, our other two grandchildren. Of course, they're all our pride and joy.
And I understand when Whit came home at lunchtime today, there was something waiting for him on the front lawn.
Yes, much to my surprise, too. I was out this morning. When I come back, our lawn is covered with pink flamingos, skunks, old buzzards, and a little sign saying something about this old buzzard is retiring today. And that was thanks to our next-door neighbor. She's the one that did that. But Whit did blame me for it, but I was innocent. Just as I'm innocent of this surprise today, too.
Yeah, that's right. Well, you kept a great secret, Joyce.
Thanks.
Thanks so much. That's Joyce Carter and Whit's grandchildren here and daughter Carol.
Well, his granddaughter, Kayla, said that Grandpa won't have to get up at 6 in the morning. And one of the people that got up with Whit early, early in the morning for a number of years was Gord McAlpine. Now, Gord began his sportscasting career in Charlottetown in March of 79 with Whit.
Well, my first recollection of the man known as Whit Carter came actually a little bit before we opened the station back on March 7th, 1977. I am a student at UPEI and been asked if I was interested in a part-time job as a sportscaster with the new CBC station. I said, sure. So I went in for an audition, and they gave me a piece of paper and had me read. And the paper had all stuff about classical music on it, like names like Mozart and Chopin, various sonatas and operas and stuff that I had never seen before. And there was this very scholarly gentleman walking around the office area in the old Federation of Labor Hall where we were when we first started. And he was wearing a suit, looking very dignified, as he always does. And I figured this guy was a pretty big wig. I figured he was like the guy who owns the station or the guy in charge, the big boss. Turns out it was just Whit Carter. I've never seen anyone enjoy summer more than Whit Carter. The station spent the whole summer getting ready for the winter. But he enjoyed life at his cottage, and he enjoyed finding a golf course that didn't have any trees, didn't have any sand traps, didn't have any water. Didn't have just wide open spaces, because that man hit the ball sideways worse than any golfer. But Whit enjoyed going golfing, I think, just to take out any frustration he may have had left after a relaxing day of workout and that little white golf ball. But he was a very enjoyable guy to play golf with. I remember going up to stand up with him many times. And I enjoyed playing golf with Whit because he was one guy I knew I could thrash every time. And he was one guy I knew would always be impressed with my golf. I know there aren't many of those people in the world. I remember back in that opening day back on March 7, 1977, and it was really the blind leading the blind. We had a lot of people who didn't know what they're doing, and Whit was kind of the glue that kept everybody together. And that seems so long ago, like more than 19 years ago now. And we've all grown up and gone on to bigger and better things. And, I look back on my association with Whit Carter and think of him in my career as one of the first important influences, somebody that I would look up to. He's a great, great man, and I hope he really enjoys his retirement, because I don't think there's anybody around that deserves to enjoy his retirement more than Whit.
That was Gord McAlpine, who's now in Edmonton. We've got some more music right now from the Barry Sorensen Quartet. Hit it.
This is Barry Messi, of course, you'll recognize that name, and Barry is the technician, and I'm standing here behind the board. And Barry, you had a wonderful story about something that went dreadfully awry when
I guess Whit and I go back just about 20 years, so there's a lot of stories you can tell.
Well, not a lot we could tell.
No, one of the funniest ones, and the one that probably demonstrates Whit's journalistic abilities was, I believe in 78, we were doing the morning show, of course, information morning at that time, and the researchers on the show didn't really do their job as well as they might have. There was a data boat in town, and they neglected to ask whether or not the captain could speak English. He spoke Greek very fluently. Anyways, when we went to air with it, Whit, like a dog with a bone, wouldn't let go. And he carried on a conversation with a man that spoke absolutely no English for about 4 minutes. And anytime I wanted to break Whit up after that, a lot of people don't realize what goes on the air. I could play that into his headset while he was on the air, just a little bit of Greek. It's all it took, and Whit was gone. This has haunted him for years.
That incisive interviewing skill, right?
Just wouldn't let it go. I want to say on behalf of myself and all the other technicians, we wish you all the best in your retirement. And I want to remind you that we're still available for a golf game anytime you want.
You're not afraid of that sideways slice thing?
You haven't seen me golf. Not at all.
You'll notice, Barry, that Turnbull never said anything about that when he was on the tape, right? He didn't mention it at all, and he was the guy who set the interview up, right? So Jeff Turnbull, wherever you are, never forget, take the group.
Thanks so much, Barry Missy.
And we're going to be continuing here in Charlottetown Hotel. We're in the Provinces Lounge at the Charlottetown Hotel. And today we surprised Whit Carter as we went on the air. He was expecting it to be a normal remote edition of Main Street. Well, if there is such a thing as a normal remote edition of Main Street, he was expecting it to go along as in one way, and all of a sudden a lot of his friends and colleagues from around the country and dropped in, both in person and on tape. And Cheryl, you've got another colleague there.
Another familiar voice, and I just want to say something about Whit that nobody else has said. There are two things that nobody else has said about Whit that I think are remarkable. Whit is the handsomest man at the CBC, and I think that all the women miss that. The other thing I'd like to say about Whit is a gentleman, and there aren't very many people who can say that about anymore, and I'm really going to miss you. Thanks so much, Ann Thurlow.
We'll have more in the next half hour of Main Street, more folks who have come along to pay tribute to a man who's had a long and distinguished career in broadcasting. But let's go back to our newsroom now, and Roger Younger.
Thank you very much, Nils. Here is Provincial News from the CBC Newsroom. The Provincial Health Department has already been searching for it.
And we have, I really want to do the Christmas tape. Maybe we'll dump it.
We could dump it out tomorrow if you
want. Let's do that.
Since it's really long.
Yeah.
And it just kind of feels funny in the
I'm thinking the Olympics might feel funny too.
It might. Yeah.
Let's do that tomorrow.
Okay.
Yeah.
Okay, so do you want to start with
one courtroom image?
I'd like to do some music because we haven't heard some in a while. So I've asked them to do a few minutes.
Okay, so we're going to do this.
Understand what I mean, because every day at 4:20, Gertrude Smith from Dartmouth would call up and say, I'd like to hear Daydream Believer by the Monkees. Every day, the same people were calling with the same songs. I just, after a couple of weeks of this, I could understand how he was going a little crazy, and I thought he'd never laugh. Never did, he went back to the island.
That's Brent Taylor he met with during his first job at CFCY in 1965. Now we'll have some more music. This is the Barry Sorensen Quartet.
Thank you.
friend and colleague of Whit Carter's over by the bar.
I'm standing here with Alan with CBC here in Charlottetown. Hi, Al.
Cheryl, how are you?
I am fine now. Tell us your Whit stories.
Well, I've got one that he knows about, and I have one that he doesn't know about.
Uh-oh.
The one he doesn't know about is, as you know, I left here, left the CBC, and went to work at CBC in Ottawa. And one of my colleagues in Ottawa was Whit Fraser.
Right.
Not going to confuse with Whit Carter, which a lot of people did, because Whit Fraser also worked here in Charlottetown, yes, in the newsroom for a while, and that's when things are really confusing. But when I was in Ottawa, Whit Fraser was there, and when you work in Ottawa, it's just axiomatic, you have to cover constitutional stories. And Whit Fraser and I covered more than our share. About 2 years ago, Whit Fraser had been retired from the CBC for a number of years at this point. Whit and I were together somewhere with a bunch of constitutional groupies. And one of them said to Whit Fraser, Whit, he said, you covered the Charlottetown Conference, didn't you? And Whit Fraser said, which one? And they said, the first one. And they said, no, that was Whit Carter. He's been in journalism a lot longer than I have. Whit Fraser, by the way, sends his very, very best regards and a long retirement. Whit, and a happy one.
Thanks, Al.
Now, Cheryl, you'll notice I've also got a bunch of quarters with me here.
I was wondering what that was all about.
I forget the year. I think it was about 6 months after we first went on the air, when we were doing really daring do things. Breakthroughs in radio at that time. We were doing phone outs. And we even, because of the massive CBC budget, we were able to do them outside the province. And at this particular one, Gilbert Clements, his honor now, the lieutenant governor, was traveling down in South America, I think, some kind of a marketing scheme, selling potatoes or tourism or something, I'm not sure which.
Water.
We thought it would be
one of those plain water things.
One of those clean ones. No, this is, I think, before, he was still in tourism before he got to environment. But we thought it'd be really great and unique and novel to phone somebody out of the province and actually do an interview, which we did, and we had the usual standard CBC questions like, hi, how are you? And we were just barely into this interview of a couple of minutes when the operator came on and said, kindly deposit another quarter, please. At which Whit politely tried to say, no, it's okay, this is a CBC call. And we got another question into his honor. And the operator came back on and says, it's 55 cents, sir, and if you don't deposit the coin sooner, I have to cut you off. Boy, I got mad. I'm not nearly the gentleman that was referred to earlier. Whit may be better looking, but he's also much more of a gentleman. I got mad, and I ripped into the operator, and shortly after that, we lost the phone call and Gilbert and everything else. Whit, have a good one.
Thanks for reminding me of that story. That's one of my favorites. It really is. I remember the day vividly. Al,
I brought my quarters with me just in case.
I think your exact words were, for God's sake, operator, get off the line. We're not in a phone booth. We're in a CBC studio.
Really impressed her, as I recall, because I think we still get cut off.
Thanks so much. That's Alan Holman.
And another colleague of Whit's who is with us via the miracle of magnetic tape is Catherine Gregory. Now, this woman worked both on the PM and the AM shows with Whit.
Well, Whit and I always had a really good working relationship. I think probably a lot of people are going to talk about how he was a really professional announcer, that he was great to work with and a really classy guy and all that. But I think what I really remember about Whit, looking back to Charlottetown, is his wardrobe. Because Whit was by far the snappiest dresser in Charlottetown. And I also remember how the one sort of sure sign that summer had come was when Whit would hang up his suit and put on his golf shirts and pants. And it always seemed like summer took like such a long time to come in Charlottetown, but that was sort of the sure sign that you were home free when Whit changed his wardrobe.
That's Catherine Gregory who worked at CBC here in Charlottetown. And of course, Whit is wearing a suit today, of course, because it's not summer yet. Whit, I was talking to Waldron Lair today, and Waldron couldn't be here, but he wanted to send along his very best wishes, and he told me a story about during the Progressive Conservative Leadership campaign one year, when there were 8 or 10 people running to become leader of the Conservative Party, and you interviewed each and every one of the candidates as they came through town. And the day you finished, you came into the CBC room and told people that Joe Clark was the guy who was going to win. Do you remember that?
Yes, I do. I do.
And as Waldron said, there was probably only you and maybe Maureen Mateer and Joe Clark who actually thought that at that point.
Just the three of us, I'm sure, but it turned out that we were right.
And you didn't resist the...
it was the only time I ever made a political evaluation and came out on it perfectly.
And I'm told you came into work smiling ear to ear the day he won.
Oh, yeah. Yeah, I really, I really blew it. Blew it up to great proportions.
Well, as I say, Waldron also sends along all his best wishes.
And we had a lot of fun together.
We have another friend on tape, too, right now. This is Barry Wheaton. Barry Wheaton was the morning news editor and an original crew member, I guess, on Information Morning, right?
Through all that heavy snow with me that Jeff Turnbull was talking about.
The guy you carried, right?
No, actually, I didn't carry him. He had further to go than I did, actually, because he had to come to my house first.
Well, Barry's now working at as a senior news editor in Thunder Bay, and he remembers basically about how you introduced him to the game of golf.
Yeah. Actually, it was quite an embarrassing moment around my introduction to the game. Whit and I used to do the morning show for years, and every day or afternoon when our shift was finishing up, Whit would always want to go to the golf course, and I could never see grown men chasing little white balls around the field. So anyway, just to get rid of him, I decided that I would go. On this particular day, we went out, and I remember it was down at, I think we used to call it Jumpin' Jack's course. And so we teed up the first one, and I don't know, I managed to get it out somewhere. And we went out to the ball, and when I got to mine, I'd never played the game before, so I pulled my tee out of my pocket, stuck it in the field, put the ball on it. And I looked at Carter, who doubled over, almost kneeling, laughing. And I didn't see what was so funny. But here I was, teeing up the ball. I thought you had to tee it up every shot. So that was my introduction to golf. It was quite embarrassing. But I enjoyed the game, became addicted that day. And for the next 6-7 years, I think we were constant buddies. We were pretty well every day. And many weekends as well. But Carter always thought he was better than I was, and he was a fierce competitor. And I'm sure he was better than I was, but I would never admit that until this day. If I can just say to Carter, he's been a good friend, and I'd like to take this opportunity to wish him well in his retirement, and just to say, now we know who's older. I'm still working, buddy.
That's Barry Wheaton, and he is working in Thunder Bay as a senior news editor.
Probably still teeing up on the fairway. I don't know.
Well, do any of the folks who remember the CSCY days remember a fellow named Happy Hal? Of course, you Happy Hal is an island boy known. It's actually Hal Hennessy, known to many as Happy Hal during his radio career at CSCY. And Happy Hal has some great memories of Whit.
I always felt so sorry for Whit. He was surrounded by a bunch of young hooligans. Bob Lurch wanted him to teach us to be CBC type announcers because, of course, we were an affiliate of the CBC. And all we wanted to do was rock, And poor Whit, he's such a classy guy. He had a lot of patience to put up with this. I'd like to congratulate him and Joyce, too. But this action, Joyce, for surviving it all. You wouldn't even have to tell Whit my name. You just have to say, Mrs. Hennessy's oldest and boldest and her first and worst sense is best of all. And also my sister Colleen and her husband Ernie Trudette. And Colleen used to babysit for Whit and Joyce. And they're here with us in Montreal now in the land of partition. And they wanted us to congratulate them as well, Al and I, and Colleen Ernie said long ago. I seem to remember one time that this may be something that sticks in my mind because I believe it did happen with them. I think I had water stated to him. Was that Whit was reading the news one day and that Kennedy studio, and I was operating at the time, and they draped it with toilet paper, which is always. And Whit was trying to read a very CBC type newscast, and then there was Air Waters wrapping toilet paper around him. Let me just again. send all the best to Whit and to Joyce from all of us here in Montreal. Their many friends, I'm sure, are very happy for them. And like I said before, just a very classy gentleman in every sense of the word, and I wish him all the best.
That's Mrs. Hennessy's oldest and boldest. Her first in her words, Happy Hal Hennessy. And a lot of folks couldn't be here, so they sent their best wishes via tape, but there is a fellow listening in the hospital right now, John Dixon, who wanted to know that he's listening with great interest and great affection. So, and we all hope John's feeling better for us.
That's right. We've been getting phone calls down here this afternoon and cards and flowers, and we've had just a troop of people coming through in almost a receiving line to shake hands and just say thank you for all the years of broadcasting on radio and on television around the island. And I think we have time for, we collected so much tape from people across the country. We only have time for about half of it today, but we do have time to squeeze in one more person who you worked with for quite a while. This is Susan Suku. And of course, she was your first co-host here in Charlottetown in Information Morning, and you guys worked together, I think, for a couple of years. I remember that time well. And she's in Moncton right now. She was at West for a while, but now she's working in the Moncton Hospital doing PR, and she had these memories.
Oh, I remember going on air with Whit the first time. In fact, the first day that we went on air was my first time on radio, and I was so glad to have a pro with me. Whit was so kind and so helpful, and he went a long way toward making me feel comfortable, even though I'm sure if I listened to that first tape, I would be terribly embarrassed at how I sound now. But Whit, he's a wonderful guy. What can I tell you? And we had so much fun doing that show together. In fact, one of our listeners wrote in and said she just loved listening to us because we were so free and easy. And Whit and I decided right then and there on the air that I was free and he was easy. When we moved in, it had been renovated from being a warehouse, and we were on the upper floor, and there was a hole in the wall in the studio right to the outdoors. And somebody hung a piece of carpet over it. Okay, now we're talking March here. It was cold in that studio, and every time the wind would blow, the carpet would flap, and it was pretty bizarre sometimes. In fact, every morning when the train went by, pretty close to the track, when the train went by, we could hear it in the studio. Oh, P.E.I., I got to hear the train go by because it was so loud, coming through that hole in the wall that, of course, the microphone picked it up. I can't believe, Whit, that you're old enough to retire, but I wish you all the best in the world. I'll never forget the fun we had and the support that you gave me, and you have a very special place in my life and in my heart.
That's Susan Suku. She was Whit's first co-host on the Information Morning here in Charlottetown. We're just going to take one more little listen to some music from Barry Sorensen Quartet.
Come 1998 or 99.
Well, we took your scripts away from you as the show started today because
yes.
People weren't listening earlier. They might not know this, but you thought it was going to be a completely different show. You prepared all kinds of material for a Charlottetown Hotel anniversary that doesn't exist and never did exist. But in spite of the fact that we took away your scripts and sort of canceled it all on earth work that you did, here's your chance finally to get some input.
Well, I was amazed that I was able to be duped the way that I was, because like you say, an anniversary that doesn't exist. And I asked all the proper questions when they said, you know, they're having a big anniversary down at the hotel. And I said, okay. I grew up next to the hotel practically, or at least I worked here next door in CFCY when the, you know, in the 50s. And so I knew that there wasn't an anniversary for the hotel. And then somebody said, well, no, it's because Rods have had it for 10 years. And I thought, well, okay, I didn't remember. And I bought that lock, stock, and barrel, came in here, and we sat around the fire and had everything all lined up and said, gee, what are we going to do now? And, you know, the show will probably, you know, like bomb because we're ready too soon. But, you know, then we came on the air and I said, good afternoon, welcome to Main Street. And then all hell broke loose. The people started streaming in. There were grandkids and people that I haven't seen in 30, 40 years. And it was just amazing. But I didn't really have any words at that time to describe my feelings. And as the afternoon wore on, I started to think, my Lord, you know, they've given me 2 hours of CBC time on the radio to celebrate my retirement. What does this mean? And so it finally sunk in that, gee, a lot of people had to be, you know, in on this deal. And I don't know how you kept it secret from me. I have no idea, but I think you should all work for the CIA or CSIS or whoever the people are that we have in this country. And I know I have no idea who to thank, except that I know that Leslie Goldstone would be a prime contributor, because she's a producer of our show. It has to go through her. And I would like to say something about Leslie, because we are going out the door sort of at the same time for different reasons. But we're both going to hang around on the island at Bucket, so don't worry about that. But I know that you had a hand in it too, didn't you? And none of it could happen unless the executive producer, Nymark, was in on it. And of course, the lady over there, Barbara Lowther, who is the big boss, she had to be part of it all too. And I thank you all very, very much from the bottom of my heart. And I want to thank everybody who came to visit today or sent cards, made telephone calls, and who have wished me all the best. And I just thank everybody.
It's just a small token. We're all going to miss you.
I want to thank everybody who had anything to do with whatever it was that came off here this afternoon. I was just totally surprised. I don't know how everybody kept it from me, but they managed to do it all day, and it was a real thrill. I guess probably the biggest thrill that I've ever got in broadcasting, to find out that we had, I don't know, so many friends. I guess I really didn't know or realize that that there were so many friends out there that, you know, appreciate what you do over the years. You go to work 9 to 5, or you go to work at 3 in the morning or whatever, and you come home and you just don't realize, I guess, that people appreciate that.
People like you. They
people
like me.
Yeah,
but it wasn't just today. This has been planned for, what, 2 months now?
Mm-hmm. A while.
Had, at least.
Aren't you glad you didn't have to do the show that they had planned? Like, that was...
Well, no, I
think you called it stupid.
I was ready for it, but I did ask some questions about why we were doing a show at the Charlottetown Hotel. I thought, you know, CBC, we don't do commercial. We don't do commercial things, so why?
We soon may have to, but...
Yeah, why are we promoting the Rod's Classic Hotel, beautiful hotel that it is, no question about that, but I just, you know, I bought it anyway. I bought whatever Leslie Goldstone told me, I always do, and so I bought it, and...
And Pat, for everybody's information at the CBC, one day Whit came home. Kim Devine had contacted me for some tapes and what have you. And one day Whit came home and he said to me, has anybody at the CBC been in contact with you? And I said, no, why? And he said, well, John Jeffrey said something to me this morning about they're doing some sort of a tribute to you.
Oh, Mr. Keep a Secret, John Jeffrey.
That was not quite right. No, he told me something about that, but no, the question that I asked you was, did anyone call you and ask you to come to the potluck dinner?
No, I'm talking about the day you come home and told me about John Jeffrey.
You're
and
not Kim supposed to talk about things like that.
And Kim Devine.
You're going to get John Jeffrey in a whole lot of trouble.
I'm sorry, John, but anyway, I thought it was like
wrong. Want to back this tape up?
Yes.
No, it's okay.
Erase that.
Sorry, we don't.
Anyway,
I didn't say a word, John.
No, we pulled it
Joyce
off.
Joyce is making it up.
We pulled it off quite nicely because I let on I knew nothing about it and said nobody had contacted me and Kim had just been at the door about an hour before that and I'm sort of panicking, but I never said a word, and but it went over smoothly. Nobody mm-hmm. knew about it.
Okay. Well, congratulations. I usually do this with the bride and the groom and ask them to kiss each other and then walk into the hotel, so
we can handle
it. Why don't you two do that? Congratulations.
Thanks, Pat.
Thanks, Pat.
Bye-bye.
Retirement thing for a year. Believe me, Whit, there'll be a lot of people find things for you to do.
I just think you'll be talking.
Well, thanks, just work that way.
Thank you so much.
Okay.
Yeah.
Going to ever ready and
eat.
I've just informed Cheryl she's going to
that I will speak.
Talking to myself.
And then Leslie and I will
start venting our thoughts.
And unison.
Start venting our thoughts.
This is one of everything. Save some for the rest of us.
Hey. The last time I saw you, Mac, you were filling your.
Yes, I came second in the line today, just behind Mr. Carter. He was very happy today to have all the verbs, all the subjects, and all the predicates in his news story. Very happy about that. So I'm pleased he's smiling.
I had nothing to do with preparing the news.
That's why it went so well.
Hi,
Sally.
It's all coming together.
Yeah. Camera interface. Sorry, Ron.
Hey, Tom.
Tom, are
you feeling you're being watched?
Tom, you're up. You're so bright today, Tom.
Watch out, Tom. Oh, just, I'm going to show you now.
Weren't you in birdcage? Oh, yeah.
Nathan Lane, everybody. Nathan Lane.
Hands up. Oh, the brightness there. This is the soup kitchen lineup.
After yesterday, the whole province knows why we're here, as it turns out. We're all here to gloat about the fact that we're managed, after all these years, to pull a fast one on the most experienced broadcaster in the entire province. I think that's a very good thing for us. It's also a very good thing for us that we've had Whit Carter with us all these years. As you know, he has been an indispensable part of every part of this service, and everything that could be done here by a broadcaster has been done by Whit and been done exceptionally well. Let me just say one more time before I proceed with the presentation, he is the handsomest man ever to come in here, okay? And that's woo! See? Okay, before we proceed, I have a couple of things to read here that have come in. We got a fax just a few minutes ago. I'd like to read this. Whit, welcome to the wonderful world of retirement. Word of caution, don't for 1 minute think that you're going to have lots of time to do the things you'd like to do. Your time will no longer be your own. Even as you read this, your name is being added to countless lists by those who believe you would love to have something to do with your time, and Whit would be the perfect person to serve on X, Y, and Z committee, now that you have nothing else to do. Seriously, retirement is a lot of fun, but don't be expecting to take life easy. I sincerely hope that the standards of broadcasting and ethics which you have maintained through your career will become a benchmark for up-and-coming journalists to emulate. Thank you for your contribution to all of our daily lives. Oh, dear. And that's from Barney Bree.
Oh, yay!
I also have a card, and I intended just to hand it to you without opening the envelope, but I got my lunch all over the envelope, so I had to open it. I'll let you read it yourself. I just want to share with everybody what it is. It's a card here from everybody in Halifax who ever worked with Whit. Here in Charlottetown has now gone on. There's everybody from Lenny to Kathy Large, who's over there, Pam Berman, who some of you will remember, all got together. They've sent you a card. I'm sure the messages are very personal, so I won't share them with everybody else. But what I would like to share with everybody else is that Wayne Collins, your colleague for many years in the morning, has got a few words that he'd like to say.
Oh, I
get to
do that again, right?
Sex. Just like that.
The power went wind.
I'm sorry.
Well, Whit, as you can notice, the cutbacks have even hit our gift wrapping department here at the CBC. No longer do we have the fancy colors. We're down to plain brown wrappers. And I can assure you, though, that whatever...
Whit likes those.
Nothing smutty, is it?
Nothing smutty, but it's in a brown, plain brown wrapper. But well done, I must say. Whoever did the writing here has been to a calligraphy class or something.
Cynthia.
Job. Lovely job. Beautiful job on the packaging. I'm just proud to have some part in this presentation today because I worked with this man for 14 years now. And I think I can say, as many of you can say as well, that not a cross word has passed between us in 14 years. And I think that speaks a lot to the gentlemanliness of this man and his ability to adapt to all kinds of situations and has certainly been exemplary in that over the years. I can't add, I don't think, any more to the wonderful accolades that we've heard through the program yesterday on Main Street. Any of you who had an opportunity to listen to some of that. Friends from the past, friends of today, all expressing their admiration, their respect, their affection for you. And it is deeply felt from all of us here today as well. Because you have been a shining example to us of professionalism. And I always think of you in terms of being the quintessential professional, the person who is there, reliable, and to get the job done, and to get it done excellently, no matter what it is, radio, television, whatever the job, you were there and performed it. And I only want to say that personally, it has been wonderful to work alongside you. And I was thinking the other night, it was over 10 years that we worked together in the mornings. And sometimes at 5:30, it'd be a cheery hello. Sometimes it'd be,
I'm
But, I mean, day in, day out, that early, one of the first people of the day I'd meet and greet would be Whit Carter. And to say that after 14 years, we've had a superb relationship based on mutual respect and affection, I don't know, it means a lot to me. And Whit, I want to say on behalf of all of us here how much we are going to miss your presence around this building. And I certainly hope that you don't make yourself a stranger, that you will drop by, because we're headed for some, as everyone knows, lean and mean times. And I think your presence around this building, even as for the odd occasional stroll through, I think will all cheer us all up along the way. So Whit, with that, I want to say that we're here to celebrate joyfully your 40 years in this business and all the friendships you've made here and with listeners across the Maritimes, and also with a little twinge of regret that it is concluding at this time. But let's make sure the friendships and the bonds will continue to last far into the future, sir.
Thank you.
Crying time again.
Yeah,
what can I say? This man said it all. I don't know, it sounded like he was talking about somebody else. But. No, it's just crying.
Yeah. Well, let's give you another present.
You want another present?
Another present.
Another present.
Well, speaking of crying, Whit,
yeah,
we'll get a couple of people who are always pretty good at it. We're bringing in the heavy troops now.
I know. If you ever want to really be sad about something or ever really want to be happy about something, all you have to do is turn to your buddies on Main Street. I think that it's great that you finished your career here at CBC on Main Street, because I think that they found in you things that nobody knew that you had. I will never forget Olympic Whit, for example. And I think that you all, as you know, all that fun that you had to these two ladies. And they have a little presentation that they would like to make as well.
And being that I'm a pathetic speech maker, I have to say that being Olympic Whit and being that I've teased you really heartily for the past 4 years, I guess.
You should be ashamed.
I have to just give you this little gift.
Which you have to take out of the bag.
That will certainly help you in your Olympic career.
Oh, God.
And there's a little card there from
me. Oh, God. Oh, God.
Try it on. Try it on.
I can imagine what this is. I can imagine what it is. I can imagine what kind of thing it is.
It's
something embarrassing.
Something very
embarrassing. Oh, no, it's not bad.
Well, maybe it's a little embarrassing.
It's not bad, and I'll tell you why. At least from what I see here.
Ever since time
began, I have worn dress socks with my slacks and thought they were cool and stylish. And I have been getting hell every time I come to work.
In the summer, he shows up with his white socks up to his knees, and I've been trying to educate him slowly. And so I thought I'd just help give you a little push along.
Wardrobe change.
I thought it was cool, but obviously not. Not in Leslie's
life. Actually, this was Joanne's inspiration. She knows that you were really worried about telling Linda that you lost your record library key.
Oh, Barbara doesn't know about that.
In Halifax.
Oh, yeah, you blew it now. Now Lowther knows.
It's a job.
But you didn't really, because we have got you your own key to the record library. Nikki Dollar hurts.
I really did lose the key, Barbara.
What do you care now?
I'm not going to come back and strip the library of all of my favorite CDs. I've already done that. So it is strange, though, because when Barbara handed the keys around to the record library, she said, you know, this is your life you've got in your hands, kind of deal. Don't lose this record library key. And sure enough, on the weekend that I went over for the retirement seminar, I walked out of here in the afternoon. I had my key with me, and I went directly home and got in the car, and Joyce and I drove to Halifax. And somewhere along the line, I guess I must have hung my trousers upside down in the hotel. Anyway, the key's gone. I don't know where the hell it is. And nobody else knows either, so I guess nobody will get into a record library.
Why did you have to take your trousers off?
Go to bed?
Oh, yeah.
At night?
For retirement.
When I got sleepy.
All right, Gerald McKay has another present today.
Oh, crying time again.
This, you know, I was thinking the last little while that what we've got here is the end of an era in broadcasting on Prince Edward Island. Whit is, well, I think, one of that gang that we had, you know, Loman and all those people who were here, and they were part of everybody's lives, and they were, in the, you know, the stars of the island. And I think that with Whit leaving the airwaves, at least for a while, that we have the end of that era. And I just thought we were so proud on Main Street to be able to have you at the end of that time, to have you before you went. And you brought so much to our show, and so much of your gameness and your sense of humor and your fun and your love of music and your love of the island. And I think one of the things that really stood out is your complete concern and interest and honest caring for the people you were talking to on a daily basis, the listeners, the guests you had in the studio, and you've been an absolute thrill to work with. You're somebody I've grown up with here on the radio, on the television, and personally speaking, I've just been so delighted to work with you. Thanks so much, and all the best.
Now do I get to open all these?
No, because it's not over yet. Oh, the tributes keep flowing in. And lucky for you, we saved, you know, one of your favorite people for the last person to honor you. And you, of course, know who I'm talking about.
Okay, Matt, go for it.
It's over now. Yeah.
The truth will out.
Yeah. Where's Brazil?
A lot of kind things have been said about Will. But I think Martin Durrell said it quite appropriately this morning on the radio, the man is not a god. And as for getting cross, never gets cross, well, when I was multi-skilled a couple of weeks ago, pretty cross at me. I couldn't understand it because I simply give him stories without a verb for me. Stories with a paragraph missing. Frank should have a last name, who's ever going to court. Just little stuff like that, you know? I had a piece of paper get caught in the machine on his last newscast. It was a 5:30 newscast, and I gave him the wrong piece of copy anyway, and the story ended with, Walter Bradley says, and then a couple of lines down, it was reforestation. So he tried to link between Bradley said about reforestation and finally gave up and said, well, that's the end of that story. Skilling was quite a failure, and Whit can testimony to that. Anyway, we have a bit of a gift for you, Whit, on behalf of the Guild. You served as an executive in one of our units years and years ago for a long, long time. And this is from Roger. It's a collection of verbs, nouns, predicates, adverbs, and adjectives that I failed to deliver over 2 months.
Talk about Anne of Green Gables. You'll never change, man.
Stockings and bread again.
Oh, dear.
Well, that's quite a story, though.
You guys are having a great time, right?
Oh, dear. I'm afraid that I am, too. But it is sort of embarrassing, and it is crying time. There's no question about that. I don't have the words to express what my feelings are this particular time. And I'm sure that none of you would either if you were in the same position. Connie maybe knows because she was in the same position a little while ago. And I think I may do what she did and say, you know, break the speeches. But I just want to say that I really appreciate all of this, and I did appreciate what happened yesterday, because that was something out of this world. I mean, that was unheard of in radio in my time, anyway, that anybody would. Dedicate a 2-hour show to one particular person. It's just crying, and that's all. I'm going to miss you all, that's for sure.
We'll miss you too, Whit.
Well, I'll miss you. Now open your presents.
Open your presents.
All right.
Start with that or leave it to the last.
It's not bad, man. It's okay.
We'll start with this one?
All right. Uh-huh. Still got a show to do.
Oh, yeah.
Hey.
All right.
At least the golf ball that Boomer was supposed to leave last night. I'd say about 3 days and I'll lose all that.
Wouldn't take me near that one.
What about that stuff?
Yeah, open the big stuff.
Oh, we have to read this maybe out loud.
What about this?
Yeah, read that one.
Here's the Main Street card. Maybe we should read that out loud. We can open the Main Street Christmas.
This is the Main Street card.
Yeah. Yeah.
Do it now.
We say, to Fireside Wit, Mr. Olympics, all we want to ask you is who's going to interview the nearly dead? Who's going to be swapping stories with Frank McCauley? And who is going to tell the truth about our guests cooking?
My heart didn't like that. Hey, that's beautiful. That's very nice. There's my potato field right there. That's gorgeous.
See where?
Oh, my God. Oh, my God.
Just gorgeous. Go for the big one?
Yeah, I see what's in there, right?
Rip into it.
Supposed to be careful.
Oh no.
No, it's gonna jump out at you. It's a changed man.
Oh Lord. Hey. Oh Lord.
Wow.
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 I don't have anything like that. That's beautiful. I'll never shoot another duck. Terrific, ain't it?
That is beautiful.
Quite the duck.
Kiss the duck.
Kiss the duck. Your Carter household tradition.
Well, actually, I have a blue jay.
Yeah?
And he kisses. Oh.
The same type.
Mm.
Yeah. Okay. Oh, that's great. Thank you very much.
Don't have to feed up right around every night. Okay, right
there. No mess.
Just
wow.
Get it.
Yeah. One more duty win, and that's to cut the cake.
That's right.
Thanks. I can handle that. Even without crumbs.
Who would dare cut into the CBC insignia?
Not me. Not until I get my first pension check.
I think the station manager should get the first piece of cake.
Well,
it's pretty close to one.
Yeah,
that's as close as you have. Yeah, it's not flat.
I didn't. I didn't. I just share.